Hey, amen. Good morning, everyone. It's great to see you. Thank you for coming. We pray that you've had a wonderful week, great day today, and to be in the house of the Lord God. Let me just share with you some coming events. Wednesday night, all the normal activities back here at the church. Remember, adults, that we're in a Sunday school room up front. And let me just share with you that Sunday mornings at 10:30, Brother Larry Cobb has a Sunday school back there, a class back there, powerful word sharing, understanding. Wednesday night, it's a great time to be in learning the Word of God. We need to learn the Word of God. It's very important. As time goes by, we just need to make sure that we have Thy Word. I've hidden my heart, O Lord. So I encourage you to be a part of these two classes. Come, listen, be a part, and enjoy that. If you need a cup of coffee to wake you up, we do have the coffee back there. You can get you a cup of coffee to wake you up, and things of this nature. So please be aware of that. Thursday, our normal prayer time, 10:30, 11:30. When I say normal, I don't want it to mean it's a routine. It's a privilege to go to the house to go before the Lord God. It's an honor to be able to go and be in His presence and spend time with Him and talk to Him. So please, please do that. And then also, next Sunday, praise the Lord God, we have our water baptism right now. We are looking up at 7 that will be baptized in water, so we're going to be dunking. And so if somebody can bring the donuts, we'll have a great time. And pertaining to that, we'll be dunking back here, and then after service, Bella will go by the dunking place and get a whole bunch of donuts, and we can have donuts afterwards. If I do not have, or if you have not, truly verified, please let me know today. I'll be contacting you this week or contacting a parent this week pertaining to water baptism. So please, please be a part of that. The devotion is in there. Like I said, I hope you enjoy the new format that we have. The prayer list is on the back. Sermon notes or a little space there that you can draw, make a face of, or whatever of me during the time. It's, like I said, every chance I get into the Lord God, it's an honor. And we are in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. It says, "Praise be to God, the Father of your Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves received from God." Here's the thing. This Christian walk is not an individual. It's just me, nobody else. This Christian walk, as you go through it, you're here to comfort one another, to lift up one another, to encourage one another. Because I've received it from the Lord God. I received it from Him. And it's my responsibility as a child of the living God to share this so that we can comfort those in trouble with the comfort that we received from God. Today I've been, and this week I've been receiving a lot of things from Him. Breath, life, a chance to read His Word, a chance to go before Him, a chance to be in the presence of God today. So I encourage you, my friends, as we get into the Word, as we get into our songs, now you need to sing a little louder. Crystal's leading today. And not that she can't lead. She's done a great job leading before and in this, but Pastor Stephanie had some engagement yesterday, and so she asked Crystal, and Crystal voluntarily said, "Yes, I'll do it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus." So I encourage you today, sing with her, worship with her, worship with the praise team as we go before Him. Heavenly Father, today I thank You. I thank You that I can say Your name. I thank You that I can get in Your presence. And I thank You that You've comforted me. The days that I've had rough, that maybe I was hurting somewhere or there was so much in my mind, You gave me comfort and rest. And today I pray that, Lord God, that's one thing that we will learn today, that we can receive Your comfort. And there are those maybe sitting beside us, those that we know, that just need that comfort of the Lord God also that we'll be able to share. Minister today. In Thy name, amen and amen. Stand.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved
Praise.
dark clouds fill my sky, Lord, just know that I will always give you praise. And when troubles on the way, I will always say, no matter come what may, I will always give you praise. I give you praise, praise, praise. I give you praise.
Think about it, church.
Of Jesus,
say the name so precious. No other name I know that can calm your fears and dry your tears and wipe away your pain. When you don't know what else to pray,
that's it, Lord.
When you can't find the words to say the name.
The name of Jesus, say the name of Jesus, say the name so precious, no other name I know. Jesus, say the name so precious. No other name I know that can calm your fears and dry your tears,
my friends, wipe away your pain
when you don't know what else to pray.
When you can't find the words to
say the name.
Say the name of Jesus. Say the name of Jesus. Say the name so precious.
Think about it, church.
No other name.
Say that name.
I know.
No other name.
Say the name of Jesus.
Say the name.
Lift a hand toward him and sing.
Jesus.
Shut yourself off. And say that name.
So precious. No other name I know that can calm your fears and dry your tears.
Oh, my friends, wipe away your pain
when you don't know what else to pray. When you can't find the words to say, say the name.
I've learned that so well in my life. With my mom. My mom never drove. She knew how to drive, but she never got a license. And my dad, being a truck driver, knew a lot of things about the road. But there's some times where my dad would have to divert because something was in the road or a vehicle was coming. And I know many of times my mother didn't go in her purse and find a prayer list. She didn't find a prayer. She didn't get the word of God out. All she would say is, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. She didn't know what the predicament was, but she knew she could call on the name of Jesus. I can tell you, if I heard it one time, I've heard it a million times. Not that my dad was a bad driver, though. But when she didn't know how to pray, all she would do. I remember laying in bed, sick. She'd get that olive oil. She put it on her fingers and put it on my forehead, and all she would say is, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. My friends, we stand on that name today. I stand on that name today. I'll tell you just a little story about myself, because you know your pastor does a lot of dumb things. I had that extended letter out yesterday and was doing some work, and I was taking it back. I forgot to put it up, and I was taking it back. I was doing so well. My wife doesn't even know about this one, so I'm telling on myself on this one, too. I had that thing, and I was walking it. And I don't know what happened, if the wind caught it or my foot kind of gave away a little bit on that concrete out there. But for a few moments, Brother Wayne, that ladder and I had a dance. I was hoping cars weren't going by because I couldn't see behind me, but I was doing this right here. And Brody, I was doing my best to put two legs down, because if I can get two legs down on that ladder, I probably could hold it up. Well, that ladder had its mind on its own. It went, Denver! Guess who held on to it? Me. And at that point in time, I just said, all right, here we go. So the ladder and I both went down to the ground. I just shook my head. Yeah, Terry's like, I didn't know that. I would have been up here and help him. I just shook myself off, my head off. And you know the man thing. We said it real quick. I'm all right. I'm cool. I'm good. Had a little scratch on my elbow, a little scratch on my knee. Kind of dust myself off. Before I got home, I made sure I had everything off. So like that, Terry wouldn't know. But I realized what I did do. I said, here we go, Lord. In the middle of me falling down, I said, here we go, Lord. And I know I learned something then, and the Lord shared with me that if you would have had Terry with you here, you probably wouldn't have done that. But it's a man thing. But call on the name of Jesus when we don't know when's about to happen. We're going to the Lord in prayer this morning. We have a prayer list. You have it there in your bulletin. Received just a message right before service. We've prayed for earlier Carol Fisher. This is, some of you may remember, Nathan Fisher's grandmother. We received a text that her breath is very shallow right now. Basically they just told her that it was time, hospice is already in. So be in prayer for Carol Fisher's family. Nathan, a young man that grew up in this church. Pray for them, that God will just minister to them. Many on this prayer list that we have today, but God is good. And I don't know if you've been using this 30 days of United Prayer that we have back there. You can pick one up. They are free. Today, I want us to pray also as a church, because we start the day a prayer for deliverance. Deliverance from addiction is what we're praying for today. Half of Americans over the age of 12 say that they used illegal substance. Half of Americans over the age of 12. Over a quarter of the Christians, men under the age of 50, view pornography on a regular basis. America needs deliverance from highly addictive behavior. We do, folks. And I encourage you, if you haven't picked one up, pick one up now. And it just gives us a prayer. But I want us to pray for deliverance. There are people in our community that are struggling. They need deliverance. So many things. I mean, I could stand up here and be the rest of the day just sharing them. You know a lot of them. So let's pray for this. Maybe you're here today and you have a need by an uplifted hand. Amen. Continue to be in prayer for Brother Rick. Our college kids, Megan went Friday. Jared's going Monday. And our college kids are about to start. School's about to start. Talking to our group over there, they start Wednesday. Some have already started on the Texas side. Let's pray for this. And I want you to also be in prayer for me. I text several folks this week. For those that call this place home, church home, but haven't been here in a while, I want you to pray for them. I don't want condemnation. God, I just pray right now. You just hit them over the top of the head with the Holy Ghost 2x4. No. I want us to pray that God will just draw their hearts back to a family, back to a place where they can feel their presence of Him. So, Father, today, I thank You for the goodness of God. I thank You for the opportunity that we can call upon the name of Jesus. I've had the privilege all my life to have Christian parents. And I heard my mama, even my daddy, but my mama would say it more and more and more. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Father, I know we've prayed for these on the prayer list for a long time. But I know that you're still in control and you're still meeting those needs, touching, giving words of encouragement. I pray for Carol Fisher's family today. Minister to them. Father, Carol has shared with me that she knows you as Savior. So I pray that, Father, she just goes into your arms. It's your will. But minister to Nathan and the family. The son, the daughter, that maybe they may have a deeper relationship with you. I pray for our church families that aren't here. Some are traveling. A lot of things are going on. But I pray that Lord Jesus Christ, let him feel your presence throughout this day. Let him know that there's a Savior that loves them and is wrapping their arms around them and protect them in all that they do. Father, right now on this day, this prayer for deliverance, it's mind-boggling to hear of all the addictive behavior that takes place. But I pray right now for men and women and children and youth that are experiencing addictions. Deliverance, Lord God, upon their lives. Let them feel your presence. Let them know that, Lord God, they can be changed because, Father, old passed away, and behold, all things become new. So let their minds realize today that they can be new in you. Father, I give you the praise and I give you the glory and all that you've done and what you're going to do in thy blessed holy name. And everyone said, amen. You may be seated. Thank you for worshiping with us. Ushers, if you come this morning for our morning tithes and offering, praise the Lord God. Amen and amen and amen. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your giving and all that you do. And let's just continue to give to the Lord God. Father, I thank you for the privilege of able to give and able to bring to your house, your storehouse. I pray right now, Lord God, meet every need in this church. Meet every home and touch them in a mighty, mighty way. Those that have to give, I pray that you will bless them. And I pray those that have not, Lord God, you will touch them and strengthen them that they will be able to give. We give you the praise. We give you the glory in thy name. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you. You want to stay? Okay. All right. We're just going ahead. Since we have older kids, we're going to let you hear the word of God. And my wife has things planned back there, but we're going to have our few kids stay here this morning. I want you to know I was privileged this week to give a pulpit devotion. Does anybody know what a pulpit devotion is? I see no hands at this time, so I guess that's indication that you did not. I did not know what a pulpit devotion is. I had to look it up. I had to watch what a pulpit devotion was. I had an opportunity to give a pulpit devotion at a Tabernacle Baptist Church this past week. And I want you to know that we are blessed because before service, they have a devotion. Someone within the church comes and he gives a devotion. Then they have praise and worship, and it was, oh, man, I enjoyed the service. I enjoyed the singing. I was just clapping and raising my hands and singing amen. And then after the praise and worship, I came up for a pulpit devotion. I was kind of like the warm-up for the pastor. I was kind of like, you know, okay, he's the first act. We're going to let him. And I got up there, and I shared something. And then after I shared, I only had like 5 or 6 minutes. And then the pastor came up, or the evangelist came up and preached. And I'm thinking, how many of us could handle three messages in one day? My mind will be boggling. So I'm not going to give a pulpit devotion right now, then give your message. But if you go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, I'm going to share something with you. I appreciate the Pastor Webb and his wife, Dr. Webb, that invited me to come share this that pulpit devotion. And it was a tremendous time, and I enjoyed it tremendously. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. I know I say one thing, but my mind says something else. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. So we fix our eyes on what is not seen. We fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. I want to share something with you today. Last week, I enjoyed preaching last week. Sometimes, though, as a pastor, we share different things. But I want to share a message with you entitled Eternal Perspective. The Apostle Paul reveals a powerful perspective on what can transform our lives. I remember years ago when the Transformers, these vehicles that were normal cars, turned into robots, and that was pretty cool. They're still out. They're still out available, and you can get them and see them, but they would transform. The meaning of perspective is this, and this is three different versions from three different dictionaries. Perspective is a way of thinking about and understanding something. It can also refer to the point of view through which the reader, observes characters, events, and happening in the literary works. And perspective can influence how people perceive and interpret reality, as we know that how they can express their opinion and feelings. We're about to be bombarded with so much on television, media, radio, and all these things. If not, it's already started. But my friends, I pray that today the church will keep its eternal perspective. I pray that we don't get caught up on all the political rhetoric, all the things that are going on, because we have to stay focused on the road. Have you ever seen anyone texting and driving? I know no one in here does. Okay, I know that. But texting and driving, I was observing someone as we were doing some of our traveling back and forth from Atlanta. And they were going down the road, and they passed me. 5 or 6 miles later, I could still kind of see them in the distance. And then they started to slow down. And I thought, okay, we're not playing tag here. All right, I'm going to pass you, pass me. And then I did notice that they kind of got to the white line on the outside, and they kind of came back in. Nothing bad. They didn't go off the road into the ditch. But I caught up with them again, Brother Richard, and guess what they were doing? They were texting. They had slowed their speed down from 75 miles per hour to about 60. Okay? You understand that when you're on an interstate, people are traveling 75, 80, some even try to do faster than that, and they're going. But all of a sudden, when you come behind a vehicle at this rate, it could be dangerous when you're driving at this rate. This person lost perspective of driving down the road and got caught up on maybe sending a text to someone or looking at something. Nothing serious happened, but something could have. And so today, what I want to share with you is what Paul shares with us pertaining to this. And today, we're going to delve into the profound truth of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. The Apostle Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians, revealed a powerful perspective that can transform us. Our focus will be on the understanding of what it means to fix our eyes on the unseen and the eternal rather than to see the temporal, the temporary, what is now. So I pray that we can open our hearts, our minds, and receive what the Lord gives. And understand my heart today. My heart today is this. I need to stay focused in these next 3 or 4 months. I need to stay focused on what God has called me to do. God has not called me to stand behind this pulpit to preach politics. God has not called me behind this pulpit to share points of view on matters that are not essential. My heart is for your eternal soul. My heart is that you can grow in the Lord God. We have to grow daily. I know some of us don't want to grow daily because that means we expand outward. But spiritually, I think, and I've said it many times, we can get so lethargic on growing that it's kind of like, no, ma'am, no, sir. First thing that I want to share with you is this, the temporary nature of the scene. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen. The New Living Translation says this way, so we don't look at the troubles we can see now. We don't look at the troubles that we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on the things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone. But the things we cannot see will last forever. Terry and I guess it was Thursday afternoon. We had to do some running around, so we were going. And I got this text from this custard place called Andy's. Today is National Custard Day. That was a profound word on my phone. 68-cent cone of custard. I shared that with my wife, and she said, that sounds like a bargain to me. Let's go. We stopped by there, and I got my 68-cent cone, and we shared it, and it was a hot day. It was nice. It was refreshing. Here's the problem, Bella. We barely made it to Target, and it was gone. And I was nice. I shared, Tina. I gave it to her, and we did. I didn't eat the whole thing. Then she finally said, well, you finish it off. I finished it off. So once we left that store, we're getting back in the vehicle, and we're trying to, what do we want for dinner? Both of our thoughts went, custard. But here's the thing. It was so nice. It was so creamy, but it was gone. And here's what I didn't like about the sale. It was only one cone per person. I have the app, and I give them my number, and they've already, check off Sam. He got his already. It was good. It didn't last. It didn't last 12 minutes. It was gone. And I said, man, I sure would like another one. See, Paul encourages the Corinthians to shift their focus from the visible troubles of the present to the invisible eternal realities. Terry and I were coming back home, and we were listening to podcast, and it was Max Lucado was being interviewed by someone, and he's just finishing out a book pertaining to this, and he was talking about the perspective of heaven. What are our eyes fixed on today? The trouble or heaven? What are we looking at all the troubles? Are we looking at the eternal part of it? My mind has to be caught up on the eternal. The Greek word for that, it means to observe or fix one's glaze intentionally. You are looking at it specifically. There's a gas station, if you call it that, mega gas station, that I think is really so funny. We just leave Little Rock, or we just left Little Rock, and it said on there, 376 miles to Buc-ee's. 376 miles. It didn't say 5 miles down the road. 300. What did it do? It gave you a sense you want to get there. I've been there. I've shopped there. I've got gas there. I bought all their some stuff. I haven't got as good as some of these folks that buy the Buc-ee's t-shirt yet. Okay, I haven't got quite that good yet. But they tell you in advance, it's coming. 3 hours away, but it's coming. Look forward to you. My friends, today, heaven is coming. The trumpet is sound. Let's get our eyes on the eternal and not the earthly. The earthly, all these things that we see today, well, what? They'll pass away. They'll be gone. But he's telling them, look, 1 John chapter 2, verse 17 in the Living Translation says this, and this world is fading away along with everything that people crave. This world, the day we're born, we start to have cells die. That little spill that I took, I wouldn't have got scratched. I had a scratch on my knee, scratch on my elbow, scratch on my other elbow. That's why when I walked in the house, my elbows were behind my back. That's why I had a napkin on my leg there to keep it from looking like it was bleeding. And Terry just, you know, oh, well, he's okay. He falls all the time. This body's getting older. I didn't have to have an amen on that one. It's fading away. But my friends, today, I'm looking forward to that day when I'll have that resurrected body. When I have a body that this cannot hold, as John states there. But anyone who does what pleases God will live forever. John's contrast to the temporary nature of this world and with the eternal life promised to those who what? Follow God's will. I want to follow His will. I want to keep my perspective on the Lord God during this whole time. People are still dying daily that don't know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. These next few months, people are still going to die. We still need to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. It still needs. When COVID came around, we still had to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Sure, we weren't able to meet in a public place like this. That's okay. There were house churches in the first century church that took off. Why? Because they kept their perspective. People were mad and angry. Let's keep our perspective. The craving of this world is fleeting. It will eventually fade away. Fade away. Here, the root word means to pass by or perish. It's gone. Probably the time of my life I really liked was my 30s. My 30s were pretty cool. My grandfather would always say that a man does not become his prime till he's 35 years old. A lot of times people would hear 25, but my grandfather would say his wisdom and his age, he's still agile and all this stuff. My 30s, I enjoyed it. We did so many fun things and skiing and all this kind of good stuff. When I got up the next morning, it didn't hurt as bad. I can't go back to my 30s. There's nothing I can do, okay? That's gone. It's faded away. But my 60s, my friend, is time in which my body may be tired, weary, bruised, and all this stuff. But my spiritual man is looking eternally toward heaven with the perspective that I can't do all the things that I used to do anymore, but I have a perspective now that God is in control and I can live for Him. I'm going to tell you something. Newsflash. God already knows who's going to win an election. He already knows. I've heard people say, well, if somebody wins, I'm moving out of this country. If somebody wins, I'm just going to say forget about it and do this. You know what? It's not going to surprise God. Nothing surprises God. The only thing that it does, it says, okay, folks, what are you going to do during this time? We keep our perspective. Imagine building a sandcastle on the beach. No matter how magnificent it looks, the tide will eventually what? Sweep it away. Similarly, the things of this earth are temporary and will be lost. Rick Warren says this, living in the light of eternity changes our priorities. My priorities now have changed from when I was younger. My priorities now are more. I got to know more of the Lord God. I have to have more of Him. Why? That's what enables me to love people more. That's what enables me to love my wife more, my kids more. That's what enables me to love somebody that when they walk into church that are filthy and dirty and say, let me tell you something, brother, there or sister, there is a Jesus Christ that loves you. And not throwing you out the door. My priorities, it changes. They become stronger eternally. The light of eternity changes our priorities. What's changing our priorities today? Second thing that I want to share with you is this, the eternal significance of the unseen. Hebrews 11:1, we know it very well. It says, now faith is a confidence in what we hope for and the assurance about what we do not see. The Living Translation says this, faith shows the reality of what we hope for. It's the evidence of the things we cannot see. Hope. Faith involves believing in the unseen and trusting God's promises. Trusting God's promises. How much do we trust God's promises? That's part of the eternal perspective. Trusting and believing in Him. Faith. It indicates trust, confidence, and assurance. I want to thank Michael. Michael helped me this week out there doing some power washing in the parking lot. Did a great job. But I think if I had Michael come up here, or let me go over here. If I had Michael come to the step right here, his back facing you, and I say, Michael, I just want you to fall back. You've heard of the trust factor. People do that. How much will Michael trust me? Because this is just not falling back. This is way back. His momentum will go. His trust factor. You've seen this before when they do the trust factor. Okay, you can fall, and then you can fall when I count to three. And by that time, you've already moved. And you said, no, you didn't wait till I said three. When we get our eternal priorities set and straight, God's promises will mean so much more to us. They'll have an impact in our lives that will change us. Paul speaks about a hope believers can have in Christ and the redemption of our bodies. He talks about that hope of what we can have in Him. Hope is inherently tied to the unseen and requires patience and confidence. Patience. The confidence that God's doing something. There used to be a song, He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. It took Him just a week to make the moon and the stars, Jupiter and Venus and Mars, and I know I messed it up. Yeah, if you want to come up here and sing, you can sing it, but not right now. He's still working on me. Pastor, you're a little bit old to work on. You need more Bondo. Some of you don't know what Bondo is. Body paint, never mind. Look it up. But He's still working on me. That's what I love about it. That's what's so cool. I don't know if that's the word today. Some of these junior hires were teaching me words at our kids camp, fifth grader, sixth grader, were teaching me words of riz and diz and Scooby-Dooby-Doo and Yahoo and all this kind of stuff. I don't know if that's all that, but let me tell you something, my friends. It's fun to see God work on me. Is it hard? Yeah. My son-in-law is working on a 1971 Ford Bronco. He has a hard top, but he's going to keep the top of it. This young man has more patience than I ever have because he's been working on it for about a year and a half now. He got an old Bronco. Took it completely apart, rusted out. Most people would have taken this to the junkyard, took the frame off, had the frame powder coated, put a new engine in it, put a new tires in it. He's finally got the body on there. It's not painted, still lacks, has no seats, there's still rust. He has so much patience. I said, why don't you just put a bucket in it and put the stew oil in it and drive it? He said, no, you got to wait. Then they're trying to decide what color to paint it. Just paint it. That's the color they're going for. They're looking at the old Ford 71, that year model paint. They're looking at being going back to the original. And he wants to go back to the original. He's not trying to pimp his ride and make it look sharp with all the. He just wants to go back to the original style. But he has patience. And here's the thing. He has the confidence, the ability to put a motor completely together. to put a transmission together, getting all this together. Sometimes I'm probably nagging him. How much have you gotten on done on the truck? And he works full time. I mean, he's a busy young man, plus dealing with my daughter and two granddaughters. Bless his heart. I'm praying for that boy every day. But he said, we'll get it maybe done by the fall. Probably by that time it had been a 2-year project. See, my friends, when it's completely right in his perspective is he saw this old beat up thing and he saw life. He saw a day in which it's a standard, and my daughter drives a standard, and he's already shared with her that it's going to be a vehicle that she drives. And here's what really is it's powerful to see, because his vision and his perspective has now worked over to her. She sees the beauty in it. She sees that one day she's going to drive it. She sees what it's going to be like. It affects people. Hope. We live by faith, trusting in God's promises, even when we can't see them with our eyes. Think about a seed planted in the ground. Even though it's unseen, we trust that it will grow and plant, grow into a plant. Our faith is like that seed, believing in the growth and the fruit that is produced. My son, they build a raised garden there and they're where they live, and he had some tomato plants, and he has two okra plants, Sister Judy. These things are 8 feet tall. I've never seen okra plants of that. I mean, and they've got a trunk on them. I mean, they're solid. These things are massive. He has some tomato plants that he has in cages that are laying it over. I mean, the trunk, the base of them are that thick. Has some of the prettiest tomatoes growing in them. But he said he just started a couple of them from seedlings, little small plants, and he just planted them. And he watered them. And it's producing fruit. And here's the thing, a little boy that didn't know anything about vegetables or fruit or anything like that nature goes to the cherry tomato plant, and if he sees a red one, doesn't matter if it's washed or not, he'll pick it up there, and before his daddy can get it, puts it in his mouth and he eats it. Why? What one person's perspective in growing and putting and planting, this other young man is now seeing parents and adults and those within the church. We have to keep our eternal perspective in gear so like that the next generation will realize this is not it. You don't live 60, 70, 80 years, you retire, you say happy trails, and you go your own way. There's more to this. It's an eternal perspective. My sister sent me a picture of the brass plaque that's now where my dad's was, and hers is just right beside it. I text her, I would have never thought the day that I would have seen both of my parents' gravestones. Never would have thought it. But I know one thing. They gave me a perspective of living this life. And I know where they are right now. I know where they stand. Charles Spurgeon says this. I love it. Faith goes up to the stars that love has built and looks out the windows which hope has opened. Faith goes up to the stars that love has built and looks out the windows that hope has built. The third thing that I want to share with you is this: the transformation power of an eternal perspective. It changes us. Colossians chapter 3, verse 2. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. Paul instructs the Colossians here to set their minds on the heavenly, to think. The think, meaning direct one's mind or thoughts. Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 says this: do not store up your treasures on earth, where moth and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal it. But store up yourself treasures in heaven, where moth and vermin do not destroy it, and where thieves cannot break in and steal it. For where your treasure is where your heart is also. I want my heart to have a perspective of heaven, an eternal perspective. Yes, there's things. I shared with Terry many times. When I get old, I want to have an old vehicle to drive. Like something from the 1960s, maybe early 70s. I love a 1961 Lincoln Continental with the suicide doors. In other words, the doors both open like this. I love that car. I have loved that car since I was a kid. I looked at one in Florida. This was a couple of years ago. $81,000. Now, it was all decked out back to the original. I guarantee you probably back in the days that was a $2,500 car. I don't know, somewhere around there. $85,000. And I tell Terry, I said, one day I'm going to drive an old car. In her words of wisdom, she says, just keep driving the one that you have. It'll be old one day. And words of wisdom from a lovely lady. Jesus teaches about an earth that is not guaranteed anything will last, and the importance of heavenly treasures. Our heart's focus should be on storing treasures in heaven, which is eternal. There used to be an old song, "Thank you for giving to the Lord. I was one that was changed." Your missions giving is a heavenly perspective. Giving to our missionaries, giving to the church is a heavenly perspective, touching lives. By focusing on the eternal treasure, our hearts line up with the eternal promise, with God's eternal promise. If our focus is on eternal treasure, our hearts align with God's eternal purpose. I know the Olympics are over with, but a marathon runner who keeps his eyes on the finish line despite the challenges along the way, their focus is on the goal that keeps them moving forward. Similar is our focus with the eternal. It helps us navigate through the trials of life and the purpose and the direction. There are basically, and there's a lot of routes, but there's three ways to get from Texarkana to Atlanta, Georgia. South, north through Little Rock, and there you can kind of cut through the southern part of Arkansas and going in. Then, but they all line up and end up in one place, Atlanta, Georgia. But we need to keep our mind on the perspective. When we get so many things around us, we will lose our mind on the eternal perspective and look at the temporal. We'll look at the things right now. How am I going to make the things financially? How am I going to be able to survive? What will happen in my house? How? Let me tell you something. The children of Israel wandered through the land, and what did God do? He protected them. He fed them. He gave them water. Why? Because he told them, there's a promised land. Now, a few of them got hard-headed and wanted to do their own thing and made a golden calf. But the goal was this, the promised land. I have to keep my eternal perspective set. What's going to happen in this world is going to happen. I can't change that. I cannot change what is happening in the Ukraine right now. I cannot change a plane in Latin America that 61 people died. But what I can do is I can change someone's life by sharing with them the gospel of Jesus Christ that eventually can change their perspective on life. It's hopeless. It's gone. John Piper states this. When you know that your father owns the land and the cattle on 1,000 hills, you don't need to worry about anything. When you know your father owns the land and the cattle on 1,000 hills, you don't need to worry about your needs or anything. I don't have to allow those things to change my perspective. If we allow our financial struggles to get our perspective, what will happen to us? It'll affect our bodies. It'll affect our minds. It'll affect our relationship with our husband or our wife or our family. It will affect us. But when we know who has the eternal, so I close with this. In 2 Colossians chapter 4, 18 calls us what? To transform, calls us to transform life by shifting our focus from the temporary to the eternal. He's calling us to change. These things will happen, but let me tell you something. God is still going to say, son, go get his kids. We recognize the fleeting nature of the visible, the significance of the unseen, and the transformation power of the eternal perspective. We are called to what? Fix our eyes on the eternal truths of God. Think on these things. I believe that's somewhere in the Word of God. By understanding the temporal nature of our current troubles and embracing the eternal perspective and living an eternal life, we experience what? A transformational shift from our faith in our daily lives. When I was a kid, all I worried about was when I got home, what kind of snacks Mom had at the house. Were there Oreos in the cupboard? Were there chocolate chips here? Was there pan dulce on the shelf? My perspective has changed now. When I go home, I want to be with Terry. I want to sit and feel the comfort of a home. When I come to church, it's a totally different perspective. When I was a kid, I came to church to see my friends, and we went outside and we played. Now when I come to church, I want to be in his presence. I just want to worship him. I want to magnify him. We are called to fix our eyes on him. So my challenge for you this week is to commit by focusing on the eternal. Whatever you've gone through these past few months, focus on the eternal. Whatever you've gone through in these last 24 hours, focus on the eternal. Reflect on the areas where you may feel where you've overly focused on the temporary, and ask God to shift your perspective in your heart, your mind, your soul. What you've been focusing on, I'm going to say this one more time. When we get, as Christians, so focused on the political world, and lose our mind, and forget about what God's called us to do, we need to get refocused. It's okay. I mean, I'm saying you need to vote. I do. You need to vote. You need to get out there. You need to have your voice heard. But it's not going to be my conversation. My conversation is this. I'm going to talk about Jesus Christ more than I'm going to talk about a politician. I'm going to share what God's doing more than what a party can say. Well, we'll take care of you here. We'll take care of you there. It's going to fall apart. One day, every government everywhere on this earth will crumble. But God's kingdom will last forever. That's the eternal perspective. So I ask you today, please stand with me. This week, I'm asking you to commit to focusing on the eternal. Look in your lives this afternoon. Spend a few moments. Like, hey, Lord God, where have I lost my perspective? It happens. Even ministers, sometimes we lose our perspective. We get so caught up in the church world, but we still need to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. We still need to have people know Jesus as a personal Savior. So, church, today, if you do not know him like you need to, it's very easy. Father, I'm coming. I'm asking you to change my perspective. I remember as a little kid, I've worn glasses since I was the age of 4. And I remember as a little kid that when I sat there in that doctor's office in San Antonio, and he put those things, they even had them back then, and he put these things up in front of my eyes on this machine, and he says, look at that chart. And he was asking, can you see those words or those letters? And I'm like, wow, I can see them. That's an A and an H and a C, instead of saying, do you see what those are? And they're just blurbs. Why? It changed my perspective. I wore glasses. Still wear a contact every other day or every day on a different eye. Still have to have my vision corrected. Maybe we need to have our perspective corrected. And let me tell you something. It's not necessarily. Sometimes we get out of whack with issues. Phones. We get out of whack with phones. We lose our perspective. We get out of whack trying to be, and school's about to start, trying to be Mr. or Mrs. Who's Who. Let's get our perspective. Bow your heads with me today. And if you need prayer today, just make your way to this front of this church. We'll pray with you. I'll pray with you. We'll pray with you. We'll agree with you. But Heavenly Father, today, I thank you for your eternal truth that transforms our lives. And today, Father, I ask to help us fix our eyes on what is unseen, the eternal, and trusting in your promises, Father. May our lives reflect your glory. As it reflects your glory as we live for you, that others will see the eternal perspective, not just an earthly perspective. Bless every home that is represented here today. Bring us back tonight with an anointing so that we can understand your word and plant it within our hearts. We say this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. May this day be the greatest day living in eternal perspective. And experience everything you can from the Lord God. God bless you. Greet one another. Love one another. Have a wonderful, wonderful afternoon.